How's everybody? This is Reverend Dr. Gerald Folsom, the senior pastor of Hemingway Memorial AME Church. This year we're virtual for our Good Friday service. Come on and smile, come on and smile. God can use technology to move mountains. So we are so happy about technology. We welcome you to our Good Friday services right here at Hemingway Memorial AME Church. Guess what we believe? Because of what's getting ready to take place at 12 noon and at 7 p.m., we truly believe somebody's gonna get saved. Somebody will get set free. Somebody's gonna be delivered. Oh yes, they're gonna be delivered. And somebody's gonna join the church. We believe that today on this Good Friday service. I'm asking you to sit back, relax, jump in, shout yes, shout hallelujah. You're gonna enjoy yourselves and know that this is what we want to say. Jesus Christ is still Lord. God bless you and enjoy the Good Friday services.
Father, let's start by saying thank you. Thank you for watching over us. Thank you for continuing to watch over us. Thank you for being with us during this crazy time. We know things are not normally what we're used to, but with you, we know everything will be just fine. Thank you for dying for our sins. Thank you. Thank you for calling on me. This is something I normally wouldn't do, but something in me told me to do it, and I'm here and just letting go and letting you take control. Thank you for bringing me back home. This is a time where I was not where I am right now. And I thought that I was at my lowest, emotionally, physically, everything. And then I saw something on social media that said, you're waiting on God, but God is waiting on you. And I knew that that was my sign to go back home. And here I am. And the blessings have not stopped since. And I thank you. We all thank you. Continue to watch over us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Lord, for dying for us. That was a happy day. Ooh. Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
When Jesus was.
When Jesus was.
When
Jesus was.
Oh, when he was.
When Jesus was.
He washed our sins away.
Oh, happy day.
My Lord, it was a happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
My Lord,
I am praying.
Somebody ought to be happy for that day.
Oh, happy day.
Somebody ought to be real happy for that day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh,
happy day.
Thank you, Jesus. Jesus. Hallelujah, somebody somewhere.
Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Luke 23:34 is the first of the last seven sayings of Christ at the cross. Forgive them, for they know not what they do. The first order of business that Jesus chose to do at the cross, as we discuss on this Good Friday, was to forgive those who crucified him, to forgive those who beat him, to forgive those who mocked and ridiculed him. To think about his journey, there were so many people who did not accept who he truly was. Yet and still in this moment, he took it upon himself to forgive them. Forgiveness is a very hard thing to do. And as I pondered on this scripture, it was very hard for me to place myself in his shoes. He had to stare face to face with who became his enemy. He had to stare face to face with all those who mocked and ridiculed him. At the cross, they were gambling for his clothes. He had to ask the Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Were they worthy of his forgiveness? Were they worthy of being exonerated? Were they worthy of the past? Were they worthy to be granted clemency? What would you do? If you and I were there at that moment, would we be on his side, or would we be on the side of forgiveness? I know somebody out there right now, you're listening to this message and you think that you would be on his side. You think you wouldn't be with the crowd yelling and screaming and calling out his name. You think that you wouldn't have sold him out like Judas for a quick dime. You think you don't require forgiveness. But I'm here to tell you on tonight that we all require forgiveness. It is at the cross that he could have been looking at us on the other side. It is at the cross that he had two beside him who were also being crucified. He had one who recognized who he truly was. He had the other who mocked him because of who he was. There was one in the last hour. There was one at the last moment. There was one who recognized who he was at the cross. It was one that wanted that forgiveness. Forgiveness is a hard thing to do. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Is there anybody on tonight that needs his forgiveness? Is there anybody on tonight that may have mocked and ridiculed him because something didn't go your way, but you only call on him or pull him out of your back pocket when you need him to show up and do something for you? What makes you different than those in the audience at the cross while Jesus was fulfilling his assignment? Are you one step like Judas from selling him out? Are you like the soldiers carrying him to what they thought would be his final resting place? Are you like those who beat and bruised him? Are you like those who served him the sour liquid when he asked for a drink? Just think, how can you forgive people who have done some god-awful things to you? How do you take your first order of business while you're staring death in the face to say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do? In that moment, we would be selfish to think only of ourselves and ask the Father to release us from the assignment. But Jesus thought fit to forgive his accusers, to forgive his enemies, to forgive those he called friends, to forgive those who was his foes right there at that moment at the cross. So on this Good Friday, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So to anybody out there that may be in need of his forgiveness, that may be in need of forgiving, he is the model. He is the way. He is the source that has every resource. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Amen.
And Jesus said to him, assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. My brothers and my sisters, we are living in days and times of uncertainty, fear, and strife. We do not know what the next minute, second, or hour holds for any of us. You can turn on the news and see how humanity has devalued the mere value of life with all these senseless killings. There's just so much hate, jealousy, and pain going on in the world that it makes you afraid to even leave your home. Not only that, but it seems to be more evil prevailing than good so much that it makes you wonder, where is God in all this? I don't know about you, but between COVID-19 and the possibility of being shot while just simply grocery shopping has me fearful and afraid. You see, I'm going to be honest and tell you that I have questioned God about these things. I said, God, how can you say that Jesus conquered it all and that all power has been given to him in heaven and on earth, but yet still see evil so prevalent everywhere? So in my alone time with God, he reminded me of John, the 14th chapter and the 27th verse, where Jesus says, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your heart be troubled and do not be afraid. You see, God had to reassure me, or better yet, reignite my assurance in his promises. You see, that word assurance has power and meaning. It means a positive declaration intended to give confidence, a promise, guarantee, pledge, vow, affirmation, or commitment. So if you go back to the scripture that I read for your hearing earlier, Luke, the 23rd chapter and the 43rd verse, we see Jesus speaking to the thief, also being crucified next to him, and assuring him that he would also be with him in paradise. Saints, I can only imagine what must have been going on in that thief's mind. I'm sure he was feeling anxious, regret, not to mention he was in unimaginable pain being nailed to a cross. But look, even in the midst of all of that, Jesus was offering comfort and assurance to him where he would spend eternity. Therefore, I want to ask you the question, where is your assurance? Let's look at the Bible, starting at verse 33 in the 23rd chapter of Luke. It says, and when they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Verse 35 says, and the people stood looking on. But even the rulers with them sneered, saying, he saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Christ, the chosen of God. Verse 39 through 43 says, then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, saying, if you are the Christ, save yourself and us. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, do you not even fear God, seeing you are under the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said to Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said to him, assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. As you can see, there was also chaos and peril going on at that time, just like it is today. The government was all out of order, people were being people, and the disciples were living in fear just because they were followers of Christ. What happened to their assurance? I mean, they had been with Jesus when he performed miracles, signs, and wonders, yet at that moment, their assurance was gone. Can you blame them? They were watching their Messiah, their King, being mocked, humiliated, beaten, and condemned for absolutely nothing. Meanwhile, despite facing death and not knowing where he would spend eternity, this thief had the audacity to put his assurance in Jesus Christ by asking him just to remember him when he enters his kingdom. And what did Jesus do? In his infinite loving kindness, putting aside his pain and agony he was going through, promised him more than what he asked for and sooner than he expected. Let me show you. Listen to what Jesus said. Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. Jesus didn't say, I'll think about it or let me check my calendar, but made this man an immediate promise. My brothers and my sisters, that's good news for us. You see, just like this thief, we too should not waver and know who to turn to in times of tribulation. So I ask you again, where is your assurance? You see, I just want to help somebody today who may be unsure of where their assurance lies because of their circumstances. I want to encourage you to be bold like the thief who put his assurance in Jesus. I know it's hard to believe in this assurance. And sometimes folk will make you think that because of your past or your present, you don't deserve the promises of God. But I hear Jesus saying, if you only knew what I had done on the cross, if you only realize who I am, you will see that I am the assurance. Jesus's crucifixion was a promise of God setting things in order for us. Just think about it and picture all the strange happenings that was going on that Good Friday. Earthquakes, the dead arising from out of the grave, and weather phenomenon that they had never seen before. But when the tearing of the veil in the temple took place after Jesus hung his head and died, God was declaring no more. God was declaring no more separation. God was declaring no more sacrifices. God was declaring no more ceremonial washings. My people are free to come to me whenever and however. Rest assured, the veil was torn once and for all for you and for me. So because of Jesus's sacrifice, it gave us unprecedented access to God the Father. Oh, my brothers and my sisters, you should rejoice simply on that blessed assurance from God. For the Bible says in Deuteronomy 31:6, that he will never leave you nor forsake you. You see, again, that's God's assurance, letting us know that his strength is always with us and that he will take care of us. God longs to welcome us into his arms and call us his own. All we must do is open our hearts to him and choose his way over our own. So respond to God's faithfulness today. Faithfulness is foundational to the very character of God. Listen, God's steadfast love for you is more sure than the very ground you walk on. Let the assurance and promises of God steady the parts of your life that feel unsure. And finally, as you step outside today or anytime this week, take time to look at the world around you. Think about the things you have put your trust or assurance in. Remember, God promises that His faithfulness would outlast anything your eyes can see. So may your assurance in Him be stirred up today. May you respond to His faithfulness with your own. And may you experience a life lived in the abundance of assurance and love, peace, and joy from a Father who loves you completely. Again, I ask you, where is your assurance? Amen.
Today I come to you from John 19, 26 through 27. And I'm coming from the New King James Version. Okay, and it says, when Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing by, he said to his mother, woman, behold your son. Then he said to the disciple, behold your mother. And from that hour, that disciple took her into his own house. Amen. Let's stop praying over the word. Father God, we come before you tonight, Father God, bringing you honor and glory, God. God, we ask that I be decreased, that you may be increased, God, that the people by the sound of my voice, God, hear your word, let it pierce their souls, that make change in their life, oh, Father God. Father God, right now in your son Jesus' name, I pray and anoint this sermon only and give it to you, God, in your name, in Jesus' name I pray, amen. 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 So when I read this, I kind of was like, what is it that you're really trying to say, God? What can I say to your people today, Father God, just from this scripture and these last seven words that Jesus had on the cross after he's been whipped, bruised, had to carry his own cross. And some of us are in that situation now where we felt like we've been whipped, we've been beat down, and now we're carrying our own cross. And now we're at a hanging place. And those that was there before are not there with him right now, his other disciples, even his brothers and sisters. So I ask myself, God, why would Jesus give his mother to his cousin John? Why would he give him to John and not his own brothers and sisters? Well, I came up with this and I heard it the other day from Hezekiah, and I want to make my sermon come from this. And the title that I got was, sometimes people have to be escorted out of the VIP section of your life to be in the regular seat. And this right here showed me that John stuck by him even through everything, even through his crucifixion, that now he's in the VIP seat. Okay, when we see VIP, we think of big stuff, like I made it there. I'm in VIP, and VIP comes with hard work. That's something that is earned. That is something that just don't come easy. Now, the regular seat, you can buy your regular seat at any price, but VIP come with a cost. And some cost is, this is what Jesus had. He had a cost on his life at this moment. And everybody that used to follow him is not following him now. I guess they got the regular seat, where John had the VIP seat. So this thing told me three things. First thing he said was, he said, woman. That's when it shifted. The other time that I heard Jesus say woman to his mother was when he did his first miracle, which was back at the wedding. And he said he wasn't ready, but his mother seen where he was ready at. So this, what I get from that is, to no matter what you're going through or how you're going through it, you still have love for your family. Even though Mary and all of them wasn't there in the beginning, but he still had love for his mom at the end. First thing I learned from this, we must first love our parents. No matter what. Sometimes our parents, you know, they misunderstand us. We don't get the voice that you need to do. They disapprove some things or decisions we may make. But the Bible clearly say that we suppose in Ephesians that we are supposed to love and honor our parents regardless, even at the end of his life, where he, I can only imagine him all bloody, all the thorns, all the pain, all the aches, and for him to look down and not see all these people that he once healed or all these people that he once prayed for. But at the end, who did he see? He saw his mother there. And then he, even in his pain, he still had compassion. And he was like, John, take care of my mother. At the end of his life, his last breath, he was still thinking about us, the people, his mother, saying, take care of us. How many of us, even though we've been hurt, or we've been hurt by our mom, or we had some disagreements with our moms, or whatever, this is Jesus saying, even though we're going through, we still have to look out for our parents, because this is what God has called us to do. And a lot of our parents now are, if you're in the 50s, 60s, 70 generations, and we are now have to be caregivers, that we, what we thought we was going to be doing, we have to stop and care for our parents and become selfless, even when we in a state where we think this is the time we're retired, this is the time we can have for us. But God said, even, whoo, God is good. Even though we are retired or we have time for us, we still have to go back and take care of our parents. So for that, that's telling me that even in our hurt times, we have to take care of our parents. And we still have responsibility for our family. We have it. See, second thing that comes to me is the responsibility of our family. The second thing, we have to respond to our family obligations. No matter what God has called us, we still have a family obligation to our family to make sure they're okay, to make sure that even in our pain and what we're going through, we have to make sure our parents are taken care of. And with that, he asked John. John was in the VIP section. John stuck with him when nobody else stuck with him, all the way to the cross. And even though the people that you expect to stick by you, not always going to be there, God had to move them to the regular seat so we can go through the VIP seating. And some of you out there are going through something right now, and Jesus had the compassion for you as well on the cross. For he said he'll never leave or forsake you. So he's sending someone there. He's sending you a John. So he's sending you someone to take care of you in this time that you need. Your John is there too. Believe it. He died on the cross for this day. And how can we all seal this? First, we learned that we first must love our family. We must love our family. We have a responsibility to our family, whether it's blood, whether it's a friend, we have a responsibility for our family. And the last thing and least thing is third, we must start praying. See, we see that that Jesus is an example of love and responsibility on the cross. Are you an example of love and responsibility off the cross? Is there some areas in your life that you need to check to see where there is some love or responsibilities that you're neglecting off the cross? Your life should be a representation of Jesus on the cross, showing compassion, even though you're in pain. There's somebody that needs to know about your pain. There's somebody else that's suffering that needs to know about your pain. Your pain is your testimony. It wasn't until Jesus died on the cross where people, he did plenty of miracles, but it wasn't until he died on the cross where he spoke the last seven words that even though it was his last seven word, it brings us into eternal life. So where is it that you lost responsibility in your family? Where is it that you lost responsibility with your parent? Because God is a God who loves us and shows compassion on the cross. Even when he was on the cross, he showed compassion. Even though he didn't see everybody that followed before him, he showed compassion. And God is, this is the time that now that we must show compassion. The same compassion that Jesus showed while dying on the cross. So today, I ask you to look in your heart, look in your spirit, look in your soul. And when you lost compassion, get back on that cross and meet that compassion And so right now, with all that being said, just look over yourself, look over your responsibilities. What have you neglected in yourself, in your prayer life? Be blessed and amen. And always remember, look into your passion. May the word be with you and meditate your heart. Amen.
Hallelujah. It's time for the offering. It's Good Friday service and it's time for the offering. Let's get excited. You can't beat God's giving. You know why you can't beat it? Because he first gave to us. Somebody ought to get excited out there. Today we want to take our offering for Good Friday service. Look, you can give electronically by Givelify. You can give electronically through PayPal. You can do it also on Cash App, $Hemingway Memorial. But also, you can write a check and make it out to Hemingway Memorial AME Church, and you can mail it in. Look, we have the baskets right here. I'm gonna put it in the basket when it comes in. You can mail it in to 6330 Gateway Boulevard, District Heights, Maryland, 20747. Also, if you're in the area, you can stop by Blazer Drive in District Heights and drop it in our mail slot. Look, I can simplify this even further for you. We're going to believe that the basket is everywhere. You can go to our website, www.HemingwayMemorialAME.org. Click on Give, and all of those ways that I just told you you can give, you can do that there. God bless you. We thank you. We pray right now for the offering. God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for those that were giving and those that were not able to give. We ask you to bless this offering, God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much for giving into Hemingway Memorial AME Church. God bless you.
God, my God, why have you forsaken me? Matthew chapter 27, verse 46. At this point in the passage, Jesus had been hanging on this cross for a while now, and in a very uncomfortable place. He was sad and wounded and vulnerable and confused, because up until this point, he had done everything that God has set him up to do. And yet, when he needed God the most, God did not answer him. At this point, Jesus felt abandoned. Now, reading and trying to understand this passage, I wanted to come at it from a different angle so that somebody in my generation or somebody younger could relate. So, I have a question. Have you ever been ghosted? It could be by a friend or a family member, a significant other, you know, or just somebody that you randomly started talking to. But have you ever been ghosted? It is literally one of the things that me myself personally cannot stand being in this generation. And for those of you who don't know what ghosted means or aren't familiar with the term, no worries. I do have a definition for you. To be ghosted or ghosting is essentially the practice of ceasing all communication and contact with someone without any warning or justification and ignoring any further attempts to reach out to that person. My generation, we literally will sit there and talk to a person for as little as an hour and then decide, I don't want to talk to this person anymore. And so we don't. And so for the person that's being ghosted, it comes with a lot of confusion because at this point it's like, what did I do that this person does not want to speak to me? Now, I know you're thinking, what does this have to do with the passage? I'm getting there. At this point, again, we see that Jesus is at an all-time low. He knew his purpose when he was there on that cross. He knew that he was born to die, but still he was searching for a reason as to why. And at this point, he had lived his life the way that God instructed him to live the entire time. And at this point, he just wanted to know why. Why was this happening to me?
Why was I feeling this way? Why, God, are you not giving me answers? To Jesus's knowledge, he and God were on the same terms. They were cool. But we see in the text that God had stopped giving Jesus instructions at this point. He stopped speaking to him. In other words, God ghosted Jesus. Now, what does this have to do with us? Most of the time, when we call on God, we want him to do something for us. Sometimes when we call on him, we are in pain, either physically, emotionally, or spiritually. So we ask for little things here and there. Lord, please get me to work safely. Lord, bless the hands that have prepared this food. Lord, please let me have enough money in my bank account. And sometimes the Lord gives us exactly what we ask for. But then with all of those blessings, we get greedy. And we get frustrated with God. And that's when we get frustrated because sometimes we ask for bigger blessings. And when those blessings don't go the way that we want them to, we get angry with God. And we forget that sometimes God stops hearing us. And so because of that, we question him. Lord, when will this happen? Lord, why won't you deliver me out of this? Lord, why are you letting me go through this? I've done everything that you asked and still nothing. Why me? And although it may seem that the answers to these questions should come easy, but because we are human and we are flawed, we don't like to wait for anything. And just because you feel that God has ghosted you, just like a person that ghosts you, God does not owe you any explanation. The funny thing is, God does not work on our timing. What he put in place for our lives is exactly that. But there's a huge difference between God and a ghost or a person that ghosts you. When someone ghosts you, there's a maybe 75% chance that you will never speak to that person ever again. But with God, even if you don't hear from him at that moment, it doesn't mean that he is not there. God sees you and is aware of everything that you go through. And we have to understand that in the midst of our pain and suffering and our trials and our tribulations, God has a reason for why we are going through this. God provides us with lessons in our lives that transform us into being a better version of him. And therefore, we have to be comfortable enough in our faith just to accept the fact that sometimes we may never get an answer. Now, this lesson serves as a reminder to anybody that's out there that is hanging on their own personal cross. If you're feeling down and out, if you're feeling all alone, just remember that just because God is not speaking to you directly does not mean that he is not coming up with a plan for your life. God does not lead us into situations that he can just ghost us and just leave us there. Eventually, what you're going through is going to pass. What you're going to put out, you're going to get in. So if you are that person that is trying to figure out where God is in your life and why he's not speaking to you, just hold on. Hold on for a little while longer, because God never left. He's not ghosting you. He's always been there.
John 19:28-29. Jesus knew that his mission was now finished. And to fulfill the scripture, he said, "I am thirsty." A jar of sour wine was sitting there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put it on a hyssop branch, and held it up to his lips. Go with me for a moment on the subject. Open your mouth. As we tiptoe into our text, we find Jesus hanging on the cross. It is about 3 p.m. and he's been working since 9, rescuing humanity from the penalty and the punishment of sin. All day long, he's been meeting the needs of others, but now he finds himself in need. Although he has been a waymaker and a miracle worker for others, he now finds himself in a situation where what he's been able to do for other people, he cannot do for himself. Have you ever been there before? You can believe God for others, but can't believe God for yourself. You can pray and call down heaven for others, but can't find the words to advocate on your own behalf. You've been able to motivate other people, but now you can't even encourage yourself. He is physically drained and in need of refreshing. So he cries out, I'm thirsty. Keep in mind, this is the same Jesus who claimed he was the living water. The same Jesus who told a Samaritan woman, if you drink the water I have, you will never be thirsty again. This same Jesus who shouted, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink, now finds himself in a desert of dehydration, needing a drink. I thought to myself, church, why does it matter now that he's thirsty? What makes his thirst so important at this point? He respectfully declined earlier when the soldiers offered to buy him a drink. He already knows that his mission is complete, and he's on the brink of death. Why did Jesus wait so late in the game to focus on his needs? Then Reverend Fowler, it hit me like a ton of bricks. He needed something to wet his whistle because he still had more he had to say. When he cried out and said, I thirst, the Bible said that they gave him vinegar to drink. I looked up what vinegar is used for, and I found that when you drink it, it causes your vocal cords to go into shock. They rub together so that when you open your mouth, nothing comes out. You see, they didn't give him the vinegar to quench his thirst. They gave it to him so that they could shut him up. They beat him until he was unrecognizable. They put a crown of thorns on his head to mess with his mind. They put nails through his feet to restrict him from running, and they stabbed him in his side. And all this time they had been trying to stop Jesus, but the mistake that they made was they neglected to put a muzzle on his mouth. You see, when they gave him the vinegar, they were hoping to shut him down because they already had seen what happens when he opens his mouth. When he opens his mouth, people get forgiven. When he opens his mouth, families are reunited. When he opens his mouth, blinded eyes can see. When he opens his mouth, the lame start to walk. When he opens his mouth, captives are set free. If there are any people under the sound of my voice, I want you to know tonight that things will happen when you open your mouth, because your mouth is the key to unlocking all you need from God. When you open your mouth, you have the power to call those things that are not as though they were. You have the power to cancel the assignment of cancer in your body, and it has to go. When you open your mouth, Satan will have to take his hands off your children because you said so. Are there any thirsty people in the room tonight? Thirsty for his peace, thirsty for his joy, and thirsty for God's presence to overflow in your life. I dare you, go ahead and obey your thirst. Go ahead and open your mouth and begin to pull on God. Your deliverance is in your mouth. Your healing is in your mouth. Your breakthrough is in your mouth. Your miracle is in your mouth. Somebody ought to open your mouth and give God a shout. Open your mouth and give God a praise. Open your mouth like you know the battle is already won. Tonight, if you're thirsty, go ahead and open your mouth.
Holy God, let me preach. Arise, Lord, and demonstrate your power. In Jesus' name we pray and say amen. John 19:30, the sixth utterance from Christ on the cross. Then Jesus took the sour wine and said, it is finished. Then he hit his head down and gave up his spirit and died. And for about 5.5 quick minutes, get up with me from the thought, it is finished, over my dead body. it is finished. If we've learned anything from the destruction, disease, and devastation that we've experienced this past year, one thing for sure and two things for certain is that some of us just need a do-over, while others have had just about enough of all of this. The trauma of this isolation and confinement has caused some of us to give up and quit. And if we're being honest on tonight, we just want this punishment, this pandemic, and this plague to be done with. Our children are overwhelmed while our relationships have failed. And if you won't say it, then I will, beloved. But y'all can have those Google classrooms and virtual meetings and them constant emails, because if we got to do one more Zoom anything, then we might end up in jail. Folks are tired of being tired where nothing seems to be changing. And so, Lord, we need some help with dealing, because the storms of life keep on raging. You said that you were for us and that you never leave us. But right now we're feeling like you're not seeing how we're battling all of these life demons. Some of us are still without jobs. Hate and crime are worse than before. The struggle got real quick and not everybody got Joe Stimmy. So there's still food and water insecurity. And so now poverty has become our new reality. Yet while we've been fasting and praying, hoping and waiting for something to shift and to stir in our homes, in our hearts, and in this broken society, Lord, we're convinced now more than ever that nothing will change or be finished until it's been brought over your dead body. Because just like Christ, we've been carrying the weight of the world on our shoulders, struggling to survive, asking you, God, to let this affliction, this cup to pass, not realizing that at this very moment, after being set up and arrested, judged and convicted, abandoned, exposed, and harassed, the Lord said that on today, my friend, this misery, this hell, it's going to be your last. No longer would we have to deal with hate, rejection, fear, and depression, but the Lord himself was about to demonstrate his power and his love for you and me, because his death would be our greatest blessing. The Savior was being whipped and wounded for our sins, beat and bruised for all our sufferings. Christ wasn't just being crucified in our place. No, baby, he was dying as me. God was rescuing all of humanity and securing our place in the kingdom and eternity by carrying the penalty for our peace upon him. And by going through this torture on this Good Friday, Jesus was about to finish what he started so that our deliverance would be covered over his dead body. And I'm not sure who needs to hear this evening, but y'all acting all funny, bad, and bougie like you can't relate or get up with this. But I just want to let someone battling know, someone struggling, someone who's been going through it, know that it is finished. Everything that we've been dealing with and all that you're going through, Christ is about to end it up and cover it under his blood, because it is finished. It's done. All the lies, all the betrayal, all the abuse, all the hate, all the oppression, all your hurt, all your pain, your past, your present, and your future, it is finished. Jesus wasn't saying that the wine was finished, nor was he saying that I am finished, but the book says that it is finished. What's finished, preacher? Jesus said everything is finished. My work here is finished. And because he was finished, our sins are finished. Our suffering is finished. Our struggles are finished. Our sorrows are finished. Slavery is finished. Sickness is finished. Sadness is finished. Scarcity is finished. And now our salvation is finished. Jesus says it is finished. But I know the world's going to deny me. Guess what? I don't care, because I did my work for them and I covered it over my dead body. The enemy might have started in the Garden of Eden, but God's about to finish it in the Garden of Gethsemane. The Father knows and sees what we've been dealing with. And on tonight, he is saying that some things in our life, it won't be finished until it's brought over his dead body. Your faults, your failures, your fears, your family, your finances, bring it over his dead body. Let him finish it for you. This is not your end. What you're dealing with won't defeat you. You are not finished. The devil better take a good look at you now, because this is the last time he's going to catch you slipping, because it is finished. It's over and you're coming out. The God of the outcome is the same God of the process. And because of that, we don't have to be prisoners to our failures when we can be free through our faith. The Lord is saying to someone watching tonight that he allowed you to go through everything you've been through to bring you right to this moment. You made it. You overcame and you survived because the spirit of a finisher is in you. God wants us to finish what he started. He that began a good work in us, he'll see it through to its completion. It's your turn and it's your time. Don't give up and don't give in. Finish the race. Finish the course. Finish the work. Finish your assignment. Finish your story. Because if a scandal couldn't stop Joseph, and if the sea couldn't stop Moses, if a wall couldn't stop Joshua, if the people couldn't stop Jonah, and if death couldn't stop Jesus on a Friday, then nothing can stop you on any day, because it is finished, and it's covered over his dead body. It's over his dead body. It's done. It's over. It's complete. Now let God finish the work he began in you and then watch him bless you. God bless y'all, fam.
God bless you, family. Here we are for the seventh of the last words that was uttered by our Messiah while he was on the cross. All the protocol has been set, and so I'm going to dig right into it. I ask that you go to your scriptures with me, Luke 23:46. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. A word of prayer. Do it right now, Jesus. Amen. People of faith throughout the world are gathered today to remember the crucifixion of Jesus on Calvary. By all accounts, Jesus, a man who was sentenced to capital punishment for the high crimes of fulfilling the prophecy. Jesus, the man whose own judge could not find any fault at trial before his own peers. Jesus, the man, you know who I'm talking about, who caused the lame to walk, the blind to see, the deaf to hear, and the dead to live. Nevertheless, my brothers and sisters, Jesus is inarguably the greatest Hebrew teacher of all time and the founder of a new Jewish school of thought that was far more successful than any other. On this Good Friday service, we commemorate the final last words of our Messiah. We find something uniquely powerful that while Jesus spent all that time on the cross, he only uttered seven last words. That's right, only seven. To no surprise to for many spiritual commentators who believe that Jesus was a man of few words anyway. You may be saying to yourself watching this broadcast, looking at the situation, why would anyone want to celebrate the day the king died? What good can be about this Good Friday service, and why will we celebrate the crucifixion of the supposed to be Son of Man? I understand your questions, but I got three goals for you today. I've come so I can be short, spiritual, and Christ-centered. And so I need you to come on and get up with me because I don't have much time for you today. As we take an examination of verse 46, Jesus did not surrender. Jesus did not give up, you may be asking. He never quit on his assignment, and he only after he spoke, he uttered his last words, he surrendered his life and breathed his last breath. Let us read it again. For into his hands I commit my spirit. Oh, you missed a good place to shout right there, brother and sister. You missed a place to offer up a praise because only after he spoke it, he died. He did not die because the nails that were in his hands. He did not die because of the situation or the circumstances around him. He did not die because of fatigue and hunger and thirst. He did not succumb to the injuries of being beat all night long, the thorn, the crown of thorns on his head. Only after he spoke, he breathed his last breath. Because it ain't over until God said it's over. That's the title of my little thesis here. That's the sermonic title of my sermon today. It ain't over until God said it's over. See, it looked dark on Friday. It was gloomy, and the world thought it was all over. They thought the story was going to end, and it seemed hopeless and defeated. In verse 44, it reads that it was now about the sixth hour, and darkness came over the whole land into the ninth hour. Verse 45 says, for the sun had stopped shining. I don't know if they mean the physical sun or the spiritual sun, but either way, that's a good place because the sun has stopped shining. And the curtain of the temple was torn into two. Let me break that down real quick. See, the temple was the holy place. You know it. Read it in the scriptures for yourself. You know the temple, the same temple that Jesus flipped the table over. The same temple that served as the hangout for society uppity folks and the affluent church members. The same temple that Peter and John was on their way to, and they met a certain lame man who had been disabled since birth. The man lay daily at the gate of the temple, and the high priest would not heal him. The inner curtain was separated, that separated the places from the Holy of Holies and the high place. That was the curtain that was torn in the middle. No wonder the curtain was torn. No wonder it was a symbolic symbol. See, Pastor Folsom, let me take a moment and put a spiritual pause in here. We have some church folks today and some preachers that have to get out the mindset that the church is just a social club. We have some preachers that want to make it all about them and not about Jesus anymore. But until we bring church relevant and put Jesus at the center of it all, we're going to be irrelevant in our kingdom business. I give you that one for free. Could you have pictured at the time the Roman soldiers standing at the feet of Jesus, spreading the word, the King of the Jews is dead? Could you picture the crowd saying, look at your God, dead. I thought he was the Son of Man. Why can't he come down from there? Remember, before Jesus died, we talked about earlier in the seven last word, he was tempted. He had two brothers on his side, two thieves, one that challenged him, the other one that celebrated him. At this point, for historical reference, under the Roman rules, crucifixion was often a long, painful, and drawn-out process. It was designed, and it was a concept that inflicted cruel and unusual punishment, which was prolonged and torturous to the death of criminals. It would not only inspire horror in the hearts of the public that was watching, but it also provided a reminder of the dangers that were at risk for any attempt to resist the Roman power or to resist the systems of oppressions. Excuse me for a moment, because that reminds me of the struggles that Black leaders had to face since Jim Crow, of being lynched in the South. They always were reminded of the risk there was to go against the systems of oppression. Jesus had the same story there. You may be going through something in life right now that looks difficult. Maybe you have been fighting the systems of oppression. Maybe the spiritual knee has been on your neck and it's been suffocating you. But I've come to remind somebody with this seven last word, it ain't over until God said it's over. I don't care what the doctor said. I don't care what the nurse report was to you. It ain't over till God said it's over. I wonder if you can go ahead and repeat that right now in your house. I'm not interested on what the outlook may be. It ain't over until God says it's over. As the old folks were saying, I will tell you like this. I don't give a rat's behind how daunting the task, how difficult the circumstancing, and how daring the situation may be. It ain't over until God said it's over. Good day, Hemingway. And may the Lord God bless you really, really good. Just remember one thing before I go. It ain't over until God says it's over. I wonder if there is somebody today that don't mind reading just a little bit further. See, I want to know if you benefited like me from spiritual hook on phonics, because brothers and sisters, the story did not end there. I know it looked bad in chapter 23. It seemed impossible. It appeared that we had lost the race, that we had counted us out. We were all dead to the cause. But see, if we read down just a little bit further, chapter 24, early on Sunday morning, the king raised. That's the good news right here. But I'm thanking God that the story did not end in chapter 23, because chapter 24, our king raises. I speak prophetically over your life right now that you will have a chapter 24 experience in your life, because it ain't over until God says it's over. Greater is on the way, my brother. Greater is on the way, my sister. It ain't over until God says it's over. Be blessed.
Hallelujah. Who taught the sun where to stand in the morning? Who taught the ocean you can only come this far? And who showed the moon where to hide till evening? grieve within me cry. I know my Redeemer lives. Yeah. The very same God that spins things in orbit runs to the